am surrounded on every side. Can't see the light of day, but I am persuaded beyond all hope you won't let go of me. I stake my claim on every word you say. You will not be late. I will sing through fire and thunder, 'cause you are on my side. I trust you with my life. I know my story, it isn't over. Even against all odds, you are faithful God. You're faithful God.
The darkest of weather, though I can't see, I still believe you're good. So I'm moving forward through crashing.
Good morning, welcome to our online service here at Leinster Baptist Church. If you're brand new and you're joining us for the first time, then we're really glad that you're here with us today, and we believe that there is a message for you if you're brand new, but we also believe that there's a message for those who are familiar with church, who call this place their home, and that we hope and pray that it does speak to you today. I'm glad I'm recording this message slightly later in the week because so much has happened. If I'd done it earlier, then I would have missed out on so much, and then I don't know if I would have spoken accurately into what's been going on. You sort of have to remind yourself we are 1 week into the year 2021, a new leaf, a new hope, and yet still so much that's gone on, so much that has changed, so much that has shaken and been uncertain, so much that has just been exposed as not having the solid foundations that we thought. For us who invest so much in this world, for us who put so much standing in the things around us, we are once again exposed. We're once again feeling vulnerable, and none of us like that. None of us feel that that is a safe place. Even if it's not our country that's been affected, it's our world that's been affected. And we just stand back and say, so much is uncertain. And the Bible speaks to this. I want to start today just with this idea in Hebrews chapter 12, where it says, God will speak and the heavens and earth will shake. Everything that is created will shake. It will be removed. Created things so that what cannot be shaken, it says, will remain. And it finishes with this in that passage in chapter 12. It says, "Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful. And so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire." We start today just with an acknowledgement that things are shaky. Things are unstable. Everything that we've created, all the systems and procedures and things that we rely on are uncertain. We realize the ground they are on is not solid. But that shouldn't deter us. That shouldn't cause us to retreat. It should cause us to look up and acknowledge that our home is not here. That our refuge and our rest is not here. Our foundations and our security is not here. But there is somewhere where it is certain, where it is safe, where it is steadfast, where it doesn't change and come and go. Something that holds firm while everything else shakes. It's the kingdom that you and I are invited to. It's the King at whose throne we come and bow today in worship and adoration and thankfulness that he has invited us to be a part of this. So today we just start this service with that acknowledgement. Jesus, you are King. You are in control. You are a kingdom that cannot be shaken, one built on love and justice and faith and truth, unchanging, the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we just begin our time today by acknowledging that, by thanking you for that, and asking that you would continue to lead us so that our ties and our roots are not sunk too deeply into this world, but we are sent into it as a sign, as a witness to this other kingdom. Help us, Lord. We are bound to be affected in some way. We are bound to have implications of the things around us. But may we rise up. May we soar above them. May through the storm we find peace. May your presence go with us as the rock-solid foundation for what's gone on this week and for whatever is next. We give it to you and ask you to be glorified in it and glorified through our going through it too. Amen. This week, we're going to be having our week of prayer. Obviously, due to the lockdown and the circumstances, we won't be able to do that in the normal way with our prayer meetings. You would have received an email if you're on the list, received some guidance and some other avenues of being connected and of praying together and of seeking God together as his people. So what that's going to look like, if you haven't heard, is there will be bite-sized videos put out every day, every weekday this week. They'll be on YouTube and on Facebook and on our website that you can tune in. Just a brief thought and a prayer to set you up and guide you through each day. There'll be a prayer guide emailed out each day if you're on the email list. I think they've been printed and shared to those who aren't, so you should have had a copy. We'll be getting one soon with a guide for each day, some prayer points, some prayer prompts to lead you in prayer, and also some practices, some just encouragement to go for a prayer walk or try different practice to engage in prayer in a different way to lead you through each day and lead us together as we're united around the same cause and purpose. There are also Zoom meetings each day, Monday at 7:30, Tuesday at 2 o'clock, Wednesday at 10 o'clock in the morning, Thursday at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, Friday at 7:30. Each day, along with the prayer guide, we'll send you out the link to that so you can just join in if you can, when you can, on each of those days. Each morning, you'll get the invite to that, so anyone can join at any point. So that will be happening as well each week, led by different people, either taking the points or encouraging us to pray together over certain matters and things that God is leading us in, as well as a prayer board that we're going to make available. Now, through the prayer guides, there is an encouragement at the end of each one to share any insights that you have, any inputs, anything you want to think that could be beneficial to others or a blessing to others, or that you'd just like others to pray about. We'd encourage you to email us to pray for them. We'll put them up on the website and make them available if that's appropriate, or we'll just pray for them ourselves. If you want it to be a private thing and you just want a few people just to pray for them, then we'll do that or pass it down the prayer chain, and that can happen too. So not what we normally do, but a multitude of different avenues to hopefully help you to engage in whatever way that you can, and for us to still be united. That is Jesus' last prayer and perhaps his most important prayer for his people, that we would be one, while things are separated, while we are apart, to be united in spirit. That's our hope, that's our goal, and that's our prayer as we go into this week, seeking him together and asking God, what would you have for us? What is your will? What does your kingdom look like as we go into this year? And so we'd encourage you to engage in that in whatever way you can. But for now, let's just pause and in reverence and awe, worship our God, our King of the unshakable kingdom. Let's do that together, shall we? I thought today I'd record the message from our lounge, mainly because it's the kind of message that I'd rather not be doing over a screen to you. And also, it's the kind of message I'd rather not do from a pulpit or a stage or any position elevated up. It's one that I would rather be doing face-to-face in a comfortable setting over a cup of tea and some nice biscuits because I think it's something personal. I think it's something that can make a difference, and it's something that I really want to try and speak as directly as I can to you, whoever you may be. As personally as I can, because I think it might make all the difference. And I think it speaks to something that many of us are feeling at the moment. I wonder, with your car, what kind of person you are. Are you the kind of person who fills the tank up when you see the red light come on? That's who I am. When I see the light, that's the indication that I'm meant to fill up. Some of you won't be like that. Some of you will be the person that when the tank gets to half full, maybe you're that person, when it gets to half full, that's the warning sign you're going to go fill it up. You start to panic. Maybe you're the quarter full. Now, when it starts to get that level, not the light yet, but the quarter full, then you think, right, I need to fill my tank up. Maybe you're even more daring than I am, and it's not when the light comes on. It's when it gets to the bottom of the red bit. When other alarms and beeps start to go off in your car, that's when you start to fill up. I wonder how many of you are that person who has let the car go empty. You left it so long that you eventually just ran out of fuel altogether. Maybe you're an elite group. I've not yet arrived at that point, although I have been close a few times. But I imagine it's not a nice feeling to get to that point of being completely empty. As we think about this, what I'm really talking about is not the fuel tank of your car, but the fuel tank of your life. Jesus invites each of us to live a full life, full to overflowing, in fact. And yet many of us, throughout this last year in particular, and through circumstances and with the start of a new year and the hope that entailed, and then the week that we've just had, are running on empty. And you can see it on your face. You can see it in the way that you walk. You can see it in the way you conduct yourself. In fact, I've had people point out to me that they're starting to notice it about myself. And so this isn't a message just for you. It's a message for me about what it means to live full and how we get back to that. Many of us say things like, I'm doing okay under the circumstances. I remember someone saying to me that circumstances are a bit like a mattress. When you're on top of them, they're lovely and comfortable and fine. When you get underneath them, though, you start to suffocate. We're not meant to be under circumstances, and yet we find ourselves under these circumstances, and they're suffocating and they're draining. And many of us, if we're honest, would say, I'm running on empty. Perhaps people have started to notice, or maybe they haven't. Maybe you've been doing it long enough that you've worked out what you need to do and how you need to act and how you need to speak and what you need to do in order to get by so that no one else can see it. And today it's going to sound basic. Today it's going to go back to simple lessons from Jesus. But today is my hope, and it's my prayer that we'll start to live full again. We'll start to realize how we can refuel our tank and get back to that place. And so I'm just going to read some of the words that Jesus himself said. A wonderful invitation and very famous words. Jesus speaking to his disciples and others who are listening in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 says this. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. One translation of this puts it in a different way. It just asks the question, if you are tired from carrying heavy burdens, come to me and I'll give you rest. Take the yoke I give you, put it on your shoulders and learn from me. I am gentle and humble, and you will find rest. This yoke is easy to bear, and this burden is light. It's this wonderful invitation for Jesus, and in it there are just some simple steps, some simple things to think about. Some of you will automatically put this in the category of coming to faith or becoming a Christian, but it's not about that. It's about living this life with Jesus, living a life of faith, living under him as our king, and what that looks like and what that entails, which means it's for everyone. Whether you're just starting out, you've just tuned in, whether you've been walking this for a while, there is a message here for you that I want to try and get across. And the first step in it, perhaps isn't what you'd expect. Jesus starts saying, if you're tired from carrying heavy burdens, if you're weary and burdened, heavy laden, one translation puts it, then come to me. The first step isn't to come to Jesus. The first step is really to get fed up, is to become dissatisfied. Nothing will happen in your life, nothing will change, nothing will go in a different direction until you get fed up with where you are. As long as you're willing to live in a rut, as long as you're willing to live stressed, as long as you're willing to live stretched and burdened, if you're willing to live sick and tired, and if you're willing to live sick and tired of being sick and tired, then nothing will happen. And Jesus starts by saying, if you're weary and heavy burdened, which means there has to be some acceptance, some realization, some acknowledgement, that's me. And I'm fed up with that being me. Without that initial recognition, you could read every book, you can hear every sermon and do nothing. And in a year, you'll be just as stressed and burdened and tired as you are today, probably more so. Unless you get fed up, nothing will be different. And Jesus' invitation is to those who are weary and burdened and will acknowledge it, who say, I don't want to live this way anymore. I can't live this way anymore. And you could possibly still hear this message to say, you know what, I'm good. I'm just going to carry on. You never intend to make the change. But that means you are continuing. You are committing to still living weary and burdened. Most of us don't make a change because we see the light, because some wonderful truth gets revealed to us and we go, that's it, I'm going to do it. Most of us only make a change because life gets painful enough. Someone once said, it's not when we see the light, it's when we feel the heat. Often, many of us, the only time we look up is because we've been put flat on our back and it's the only direction we can look. And Jesus comes and says, if you're tired, you need to recognize that. If you're tired of running on empty, if you are fed up with the pace of your life and you are willing to say, I refuse to live this way, something is broken, then today Jesus comes and presents a choice for you. The choice is either to continue and break down or to come and find a breakthrough. Because we have had enough stories of people who are successful but stressed, who are famous but aren't fulfilled, who have a lot of money but not a lot of meaning, who have a lot to live on but not a lot to live for. And we're seeing this increase, we're seeing this hit children who carry around tiny comparison tools in their pockets, the people who are dissatisfied, tired and weary. And today my first invite to you is to just acknowledge it and to say, I'm fed up. And that means I'm in. If that's you today, if that's how you feel, if you're ready to admit that, then this might be the most important message that you hear this year so far. And I know you've probably only heard two, but it might be the most important message for the rest of the year too. Because if you are in that position, then Jesus' invitation is this. If you're weary and burdened, if you're tired and flat out, if you can't carry on, here's the first step. Come to me. Now, I know this is a church service, so that isn't a revolutionary idea. You're not going to fall off your seat in amazement that I've pointed that out. Jesus actually uses three verbs. He uses come and take and learn, and we're going to look at all of them today. But his first one is come to me. The first thing you need to do, if that's where you are, is to come to me, bringing me the good and the bad, bringing to me the frustrating and the painful, bringing to me the shameful and the exhausting. And if you do that, he says, if you come to me, I will give you a really good sermon. Obviously, he doesn't. he doesn't say, I'm going to give you a good sermon. He doesn't say, I'll give you some good pointers. I'll give you a good technique. I'll give you some methods to cope with it. What he says is, if you come to me, I will give you rest. I want to just point out what Jesus is saying. He's saying who you need to come to, and he's going to tell you what he gives you when you come to him. The first invite from Jesus isn't to come to church. It isn't to come to a religion. It isn't to come to a set of rules. It isn't to come to regulations. The antidote for your stress, your burden, your weariness is not a time management technique, even though that's not bad. It's not a program for stress relief. It isn't some coping mechanisms. It isn't a philosophy. It's a person. Now, none of those things are necessarily bad, but you don't need them as much as you need him. Because unless you find a person to give these things to, all those other things don't know you, and they don't see you, and they don't hear you, and they don't get you. Only a person can do those things. Only a person can love you. And only a person can see exactly where you are. Not everyone else, and not how this might help someone, and this person found this useful, and this person got out of it via this. They only a person can see you as you are, where you are, how you are, and meet you in that place. And so Jesus says, the first thing you need is to come to me. Throughout the New Testament, people came to Jesus for all kinds of reasons. Some came for forgiveness, some came for healing, some came for advice, some came for eternal life, some came for food, some came to criticize, some came to question, some came as skeptics. And what's interesting is Jesus didn't seem to care why they came as long as they came. And he doesn't care why you come. You can say, I'm wiped out, or I'm worn out, or I'm tired, or I'm lonely, or I'm guilty, or I'm ashamed, or I'm angry, or I'm bored, or I'm unfulfilled, or I'm worried. He doesn't care as long as you come to him with it. It's him. And at the end of this message, I'm going to give you a way, I'm going to lead you in a way to do that. But you just need to recognize that's our first step. If we're tired, what we need is not a technique and a method or just some bit of encouragement to get us through. We need him. And when we come to him, what he says is, I will give you rest. I will give you a peace in your heart. I will impart to you something that I have and no one else does, that I will give to you. And it will be yours. John 6:37 says, whoever comes to me, I will never reject. You don't have to worry if you come to him, whether he will or he won't. It doesn't matter to him your background, or what you're doing right now, or what you plan to do tomorrow. It doesn't matter. It just says, just come. I'm the answer. Not a seminar or a therapy or a book. Come to me and I'll give you rest. And what he goes on to say is, it's rest for your soul. This is more than physical rest. And most of us, our problem isn't tired muscles. It's a tired mind. It's a tired soul. Most of us, it's physically, we need to do more exercise, not less. But it's the worry, it's the comparison, it's the fear that holds us. You know how to unwind physically, and you know how to maybe unwind emotionally, but getting rest for your soul, that inner part of you, how do you rest that? Most of us, it's through entertainment, just tuning out, it's a hobby, it's a sport, all of that kind of gives us some sort of rest. But Jesus says, unless you come to me, none of those things can restore your soul. You might deal with the physical to an extent and the emotional, but that spiritual inner you will still be weary and burdened. But come to me and I'll give you rest in that place. Isaiah 40 says this, he gives power to those who are tired and worn out if you come to him. This is different to the advice you may get elsewhere. Most other advice says you go and you have more, or you be more, or you get more, or you have to, there's more that you have to do. But if we ask how's that going, we'd all admit that hasn't filled the emptiness that we're feeling. Jesus doesn't say go, he says come to me. Last week I talked about this invitation to prayer that Jesus gives in the Sermon on the Mount. And in Matthew 6, the one translation puts it in a real simple, wonderful way. It says, here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so you won't be tempted to role play before God. And just be there as simply and honestly as you can manage. And when you do it, it says, the focus will shift from you to God. And you'll begin to sense his grace. Come to him. You've got to get fed up. And then you've got to come to him. Now, some of you at this point will say, okay, I get that, I understand that. But I have. I think I already have, Dean, and I still don't feel full. I came to faith, I came to Jesus, I gave him these things, but I still don't feel full. So what's the problem? Well, as I pointed out, Jesus gives three instructions. One's to come, but there are two more that we need to look at. The second is that we need to take. Come to me, all you who are wearied and burdened, I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Come to me and take my yoke. The yoke, you farmers will know, and many of you have been in church a while will already know, it's the wooden implement that's put on cattle or horses to bind them together so that they can pull a heavy cart together. They're united. It's a piece of wood that binds them and connects them in a way that they can pull heavier loads than they could by themselves. And that's what Jesus says. I want you to take this yoke on you so that you can pull the load that you're having to carry. Now, for many of us, we'd say, that doesn't sound very relaxing. I thought you meant to rest me. I don't want something else put on me. I'm already carrying too much. And now you, Jesus, you're saying you're going to put more on me? That doesn't sound helpful. But what Jesus is saying is not, I'm coming to put something on you, but I'm coming to step into the yoke with you, to put this yoke on so that you can pull the load together. The yoke is a symbol of partnership. It's a symbol of having someone else beside you, a life partner, someone who walks with you and carries with you. It's not to put more on you, it's to take more off you so that you realize you don't have to do this and you weren't meant or created to do this by yourself. Jesus says, you yoke with me and we pull it together. And you're so overloaded because you're carrying it all by yourself. You came to me, but you never took this on yourself. I never intended you just to come to me and then go away by yourself. I intended to come and then us be yoked together, connected with something that fits your shape perfectly so that we can carry it as one. Psalm 55 puts it like this in one translation. It says, pile your troubles on God's shoulders and he'll carry your load and help you out. If you are overloaded at this very second, it means one thing, that you aren't yoked to Jesus. Because he goes on to say, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I wonder, would those be two words that people use to describe you? Would you use those words to describe yourself? Easy and light. If those two words aren't descriptive of you, then you know you must be carrying this load by yourself. If it's not easy and it's not light, it's because you can't be yoked to him. You're not in partnership. You're not letting him pull his weight. And every time you get disconnected, you'll find it crushing you. And it's just a reminder, you need to take this yoke. He offers to be a partner, not just to come to him and give him it, but to then carry it with you and support you and bear the load that you can't so that it becomes easy and light enough. There are some wonderful people that I'm sure you can bring to mind who you see this, who through trial and difficulty and suffering and pain, you look at them and say, how do you have this spirit of lightness about you? How are you so, how is there joy in your life? How is there peace? And here's the answer. Because they don't carry it by themselves. They take this yoke and they say, Jesus, you are my partner. I cannot carry this by myself. I've learned that. Carry it with me. The yoke is also a picture of control. And here's one of the key struggles we have, why we are so burdened and stretched, because we try to control everything. And the greater your need to control everything, the more overloaded you will be and the less full you will be living. The only thing God wants you to control, it's been pointed out, is yourself. The Bible calls it self-control. It's a fruit of the Spirit. And even that has its limits as to how much you can do. But a yoke isn't just something to bind together to lighten a load. It's something that's used to control the animals, to stop them wandering off into a ditch and to keep them going at a pace that they can sustain. When I'm yoked with Jesus, we move together in the same direction and we move at the same pace. I can't go faster than him. I can't outrun him. I can't go in a different direction because I'm yoked to him and he keeps me from going off my own and getting into trouble. The Bible says we keep in step with the Spirit. It's the same idea. You can't go faster than God. And as much as you may find that frustrating, he's never in a hurry. And we often are. Some of us need a pace setter. You see these marathon runners who run, and if you ever run in a marathon, you'll know there are people with big flags on their back with a time on it saying, if you keep up with me, then you'll finish the marathon in this time, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, whatever it might be. And if you keep up with them, then you're at the pace where you'll arrive at the time that you want to. And Jesus comes not just to guide us. You and I need more than a direction to head in. We need a pace setter. Someone who can set the pace that we need to speed us up when we need to, and to slow us down. What's interesting, and how I came to realize, is that nowhere in the Bible is it recorded that Jesus ran anywhere. He was never in a hurry. There's a poem that was written based on the Lord's My Shepherd that says this: the Lord is my pace setter. I shall not rush. He makes me stop and rest for quiet intervals. He provides me with images of stillness which restore my serenity. He leads me in the ways of efficiency through a calmness of mind, and his guidance is peace. Even though I have a great many things to accomplish this day, I will not fret. For his presence is here, his timelessness, his all-importance will keep me in balance. He prepares refreshment and renewal in the midst of my activity by anointing my head with the oil of tranquility. My cup of joyous energy overflows. Surely harmony and effectiveness shall be the fruits of my hours. For I shall walk in the pace of my Lord and dwell in his house forever. A pace to run at. The secret to all this is that you will be yoked to something in your life. If it's not to him, then it'll be something else. Something else will drive and push and pull you. Expectations, opinions, the multitude of things that there are to do and to cope with and to manage. But only one yoke is needed. Bob Dylan said it like this: you're going to have to serve somebody. Indeed, you're going to have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're going to have to serve somebody. And you are. So Jesus says, take my yoke. If you're going to be yoked, why not choose the easiest, the lightest? Why choose the one that leads to stress and being overextended? It's an exchange. My heavy yoke for his light one. Fact is, for you, you don't have a yoke. You probably have a dozen. So many yokes that others have put on you, that you've put on you, and you're being crushed by them. The yoke's on you. Sorry, that's a terrible pun. But it's true that there are so many yokes. They pile on top of each other. We think if we get on a holiday, if we can just get away. But the problem, wherever we go, we take us with us. And it's up here. We have to give up control, or we will never have peace. And we have to take his yoke where he picks the pace and the direction. It's light and it's easy. And every time you take it off, you'll find it getting too heavy for you. Come to me and take my yoke. But he goes on, there's one last instruction. Come to me and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. And then he says, and learn from me. Learn from me. This isn't just going to come and get what you need and then walk away. That as we walk together, as we are yoked, you will learn from me. Because you and I didn't get overloaded overnight. And we won't get unloaded overnight. The longer that you've been living under this, the longer it will probably take to get out from under this. But if we pace ourselves and walk with him, then Jesus invites us to learn from him. Watch him, his model, to live with purpose and peace. And to do the same for ourselves. Healthy and balanced. Learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart. And it's taken me a while to figure out what he's saying there, because I thought, learn from me because I'm gentle and humble. Why are those things, why reference them? I would rather he said, learn from me because I have endurance and stamina, because that's what I think I need. Or learn from me because I am strong and stable and I can provide for you. Or learn from me and I'll give you great productivity and excellent coping techniques. But the words he chooses are, learn from me because I'm gentle and humble. And the reason I believe he chooses them is because the antidote, the biggest cause of our overload, is the opposite. It's arrogance and it's aggression. I'm aggressive, not gentle, which means I don't want to wait. I don't want to pause. I don't want to consider. I'm aggressive. I want to jump in. I want to push ahead. I want to do it now, 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 now. That aggression of keep going, go on. And I'm arrogant. I want to control everything. I know what's best for me and I know what's best for you too. Our ego, these two things are responsible for more stress than anything else. We want to Simply try and do it all and try and do it now. Arrogance and aggression. And Jesus says the antidote is gentleness, not aggression, and humility, not arrogance. To realize you and I are not the savior of everybody, we're not the savior of anybody, and I'm not the king of anyone. And since the Lord knows my steps, why do I always have to try and figure them out for myself? Instead, I can learn from him. Psalm 142, I was reading it today, let me just find it. There's a verse and it says, when my spirit grows faint within me, it is you who knows my way. Another version put it, when you're ready to give up, the God who made you knows what you should do. When you're ready to give up, is that how you feel? I'm ready to give up on my marriage, on my health, on my career, on my life. If that's you, he knows what you should do. His yoke will lead you if you walk with him and learn from him. Come to me. Take off me and learn from me. See, 2021, as we think about this year, and I think about us as a church, I don't care if we're the biggest church. I don't care if we're the most impressive. I don't care if we're the most relevant. My concern is that we are the healthiest church that we can be. And living outside of this, living tired and burdened and not living full, is unhealthy. Spiritually unhealthy and spiritually dangerously unhealthy. And yet we have an invite here to be different. The world is crying out for models who would live in this way. People who live full when everyone else is trying their best to get full. And you and I have the possibility of choosing that today. If people just look at us and all they see is, well, you're like me, but you go to a few extra meetings a week, to which they just say no thank you, that's not full. We're not displaying a full life that Jesus came to bring. So I want to ask you today, what's weighing you down? I don't know what it is. It can be problems, it can be finances, health, sick relatives. Maybe you can't put your finger on it. There's so many different yokes that you can't identify what it is. But I believe that God brought you here today to this message online to say this to you. Come to me. Come to me. Come to me, all you who labor. You workaholics, you heavy laden, you who are overburdened, and I will ease and relieve and refresh your souls. He brought you here today to tell you, take my yoke. Team up, partner with me, and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. And if you do this, you will find rest and refreshment and recreation and a blessed quiet for your souls. This might be the most important invitation you'll receive this year, maybe in your life. Because when this is all over, there are going to be weddings to go to and dedications to have and baptisms and missed birthdays and missed births, and you're going to get invites to all of them this year. But this will be the most important one that you get. Jesus meeting with you now to say, come to me. Have you done that? Maybe you've been in church your whole life, but you've never done that. Maybe you've tuned in today for the first time, and wonderful time to do it, because I'm telling you, this is the first step. Once you're fed up, come to me. Give up control, take his yoke, and learn to trust, learn to walk with him. I'd like just to guide you now in a first step in that. If you'd like to close your eyes, bow your head, just be still, take a deep breath for a moment. And I will say a prayer that you can agree with in your heart. Have you ever come to Jesus? The start of that is unloading to him. It's talking to Jesus about it, telling Jesus what's frustrating you. Your friends and your family may not want to hear it, but Jesus will never ignore you. He wants to take, he wants to hear those burdens, he wants to partner with you, he wants to be your pace setter. And if you're willing to take that step today, then you can pray this prayer in your heart, you can listen along and agree. Dear God, I am tired of being tired all the time. I'm tired of trying to control everything. I'm tired of life without rest and peace. Forgive me, God, for all the ways that I've tried to be God, all that I've tried to control. Forgive me for the things that I turn to for relief instead of you. Today, Jesus, I come back to you. I want you to be the pace setter of my life. I want to stop trying to control what I couldn't control anyway. Please forgive me my arrogance. Forgive me my insecurities to take on more than I could. Forgive me for proudly overloading my schedule, filling my life with things that squeezed out what is most important. Today I want to start learning from you. I want to be gentle and humble like you, so that I can have the peace that you offer. Amen. With your head still bowed, if you prayed that and you meant that in your heart, then today is a turning point for you. You may have called yourself a Christian for years, but today something may have changed. Something may be different. You may realize the next step for you. Come, take the yoke, learn from him. If that is you and you're not sure what that might look like, then I'd love for you to get in touch, email us, call us, contact, send a message any way that you can. Get in touch and we'd love to help you, pray with you, and give you some next steps and some input into that. I'm just going to pray now for you. Father, I thank you for freedom. I thank you for the freedom that will come today as they choose to come to you. I thank you for the release that comes from giving up control and taking your yoke. I thank you for the potential and the possibility ahead of us as we learn to walk and to trust you. For those who've made that choice today, who are fed up, but have taken their first step towards you, I pray you would confirm that you would meet with them, that they would sense some of that peace already growing in their heart, some of that relief, their shoulders lighter, their burden lifted. I pray your blessing on them. I pray they know your joy over them. And for all of us, Lord, lead us on through this year, yoked to you, learning from you, and full as you intended us to be. We ask it in your name, Jesus. Amen.